Simon, thanks for joining us at what is now the fifth wind industry forum. You've been coming to these events for a while and indeed have been a big supporter and follower of the industry over those last 5 years. What are your reflections on what's changed for the industry over that period?
I think the most striking thing to me is that the industry as a sector of the Australian economy is much more mature. It sees itself as a corporate player, a corporate contributor, and one that has to engage very strongly with community and government in a way that perhaps we didn't see 5 years ago. But right now, the volume and level of activity is extraordinary. It's impossible to keep up with all the new developments.
What are some of the other things that have really driven the industry, you think, over that last 5 years?
Clearly, economic instruments on the part of state and federal governments have been very, very important. The federal rate, getting stability on the federal rate, has really incentivised growth. But equally, state-based contracting, particularly here in Victoria with the reverse auction scheme, building on the success of the ACT reverse auction scheme, getting real price discovery.
We've obviously had a challenging decade as far as stability at the federal level around policy, the renewable energy target, and obviously now a discussion about what comes next after 2020. Where do you see that going, and how important do you think the states and territories will continue to be?
Well, I think the states and territories are going to continue to play a really important role, and in a couple of ways. First of all, their commitments to contracting for projects directly through reverse auctions, and we've seen that now in Queensland, in Victoria, in the ACT, and in South Australia. They are all driving innovation and development. So in the same way that we incentivised rooftop solar a decade ago, we're now incentivising and supporting and bringing forward volume in battery storage. That's really important. In terms of federal policy settings, really we're still trapped in a highly partisan, very difficult policy environment. States and territories will have a really key role in determining and shaping what happens, for example, around the National Energy Guarantee.
You've mentioned a social license a couple of times now, and I'm interested in your insight into how the wind industry in particular has change its behaviour and its engagement with local communities around these projects, and where you think the areas are for further development and improvement in years to come as we see many, many more wind and indeed solar projects being rolled out in parts of rural and regional Australia where maybe they haven't seen these sorts of projects before.
Yeah, so the industry has matured, and that has been underpinned by state governments in the ACT, in Victoria, elsewhere, saying you're not going to get a contract from us unless you demonstrate good social license, good community engagement, good local benefit sharing. I think moving forward, we need to see more innovation in benefit sharing. We need to see the industry stepping up and supporting supply chain augmentation in particular. So in Victoria, for example, there's a mandated level of local steel to be provided as part of the reverse auction for wind and indeed solar projects in the state.
We're seeing around about 3,000 megawatts of wind projects alone having been committed and moving on to construction and ultimately connecting up to the traditional energy network. What do you see as some of the challenges for that in that grid connection space, and how do we overcome some of those issues?
Grid constraints clearly are a big and emerging issue. Our electricity networks have not been designed to take electricity from where the powerful wind and solar resource is and bring it back to the areas of load, like from northwestern Victoria back to the CBD of Melbourne. So we need to look at how we redesign our networks to open up that investment. But equally, do it in a way that's economically efficient, but which also is timely, because the existing regulatory frameworks are, in my view, are not timely enough. They take a long time before a decision is made on regulated revenues, and then you've still got to go through permitting approvals. If you're building new transmission infrastructure, you've got to acquire the easements. These are very, very long time frames. So I think those two issues really need to be work through, and they really need to be landed in terms of our future policy direction, I would suggest, in the next 12 to 18 months. Otherwise, we do face significant grid constraint between 2020 and 2025, and that will deter or inhibit the level of investment that might otherwise occur in regional and rural centres.
If you and I are back here in another 5 years' time, how do you think the industry will have progressed, and what will it have achieved over the next five-year period?
Well, my hope would be that the industry has continued to drive down the price of new build generation so that it is, without a doubt, competitive, even potentially with some of the incumbent fossil generators. I think that's entirely feasible over the next 5 to 8 years to see continued price reductions. I think importantly though, from my perspective, it will have supported a more mature supply chain within Australia. We should not be importing so many of these components for wind from outside markets. There will always be an element of that, but so much more could be built locally, and that could support jobs and skills in Australia and in the communities that are hosting these projects. So I would like to definitely see that as an outcome. I'd also like to see much more community ownership of projects, with developers partnering with their local communities to allow people to be part of the return that these projects deliver. And that, we know, has been central in getting success in the growth of wind in European markets in particular. So it would be great to see that in the Australian market as well. And I think finally, I'd like to see a great level of diversity around the types of project developers we see in the market. Small and large scale have a role to play. Community ownership as well as entirely corporate, and a maturing of the customer base through aggregated buying groups that allow small and medium-sized businesses to be part of this clean energy transition. I think those are the key trends that I'd really like to see consolidated in the next 5 years.
Well, thanks very much, Simon, for joining us here at the Wind Industry Forum for 2018, sharing your insights, and thank you for your leadership and ongoing support for the industry.